Good afternoon, everybody. Can you all hear me at the back? Yes, great. So good afternoon and welcome to the University of South Australia. I'm delighted that you're joining us for our third and final Successful Ageing Seminar of 2018. My name is Fern Cargill and I'll be your MC for today. Our usual MC, Ruth Grant, is on holiday, a very well-deserved break, so she'll be joining us again next year once our seminars recommence. If you're wearing a hearing device, please use the T setting on your hearing aid to take advantage of the hearing loop that's installed in the seminar theatre. Headsets are available at the front, so please do take one if you need to. And before we start, I would like to acknowledge that we're meeting on the traditional land of the Kaurna people, and we recognise and respect their cultural heritage, their beliefs and relationship with the land. A few small housekeeping points just before we start our presentations today. Toilets are located either side of the bottom entrance of the lecture theatre. Males go to the left and females over to the right. If you have a mobile phone, can you please either turn it off or switch it to silent? And in the unlikely event of an emergency evacuation, do note where your nearest exit is. And if that does happen, just follow the instructions of the staff who will guide you to the evacuation assembly point. I hope you picked up the leaflets from the table as you walked in today. As you know, we do really value your feedback, so please do complete the feedback form as it does help to guide our decisions about future seminars. And there's a box just at the front of the lecture theatre where you can pop those completed forms, and there's also some pens there too. So on to today's seminar. We'll be looking at understanding and improving outcomes for cancer patients and survivors in rural areas. And we'll be hearing today from two very distinguished presenters, Dr. Kate Gunn and Professor Ian Olver. The first presentation will last for around 30 minutes, or 33 minutes, as Kate advised us earlier. And there will be an opportunity for you to ask questions straight afterwards. There'll be roving microphones to help with that. After that, we'll break for refreshments, which will be at about 10 to 3. And then we will return to the lecture theatre to hear from our second presenter for today. So our first speaker today is Dr. Kate Gunn. Kate is a research fellow at UniSA who has recently returned from a Churchill Fellowship, a very notable achievement. Kate carries out both qualitative and quantitative research in psycho-oncology, rural health, and rural mental health. This work is strengthened by her background growing up on a farm in an isolated rural community, and also from her work experience as a clinical psychologist. Today, Kate will be discussing cancer outcomes, and in particular, why people in rural areas affected by cancer experience poorer outcomes than those people in urban areas. Kate will outline findings on how these issues could be best addressed, as well as highlighting some tried and trusted strategies. So please welcome Dr. Kate Gunn.
Thank you, Fern. Okay, so as you've just heard, I work as a clinical psychologist and at UniSA doing research into rural health and rural mental health issues with a focus on understanding and addressing disparities in cancer outcomes experienced by people living in rural areas. One of the reasons I'm passionate about this topic is because I grew up on this farm, which is about 650 kilometres away from Adelaide near Port Kenny. And my parents and my brother still run the farm, and I get back there as much as I can. You can actually see me there with my brother helping with shearing a few weeks ago. But what I guess this means is that I've witnessed firsthand some of the challenges as well as benefits of living in rural communities. And so I'm really grateful for the opportunity to be able to work with people like Ian and at UniSA to try and address some of these important rural health issues. But putting aside my personal motivations, improving cancer care for rural Australians is important because a third of our population lives outside of metropolitan centres, and that is in areas of Australia that are on this map coloured anything other than the darkest green. So if you fall into this category and you're diagnosed with cancer, your experience is likely to be very different than the experiences of someone who lives in a major city. So to paint a picture of this, let's just take Bob, who hypothetically speaking is from Port Kenny, like me, and John from Prospect. So both are the same age, but people like Bob who live in remote areas are likely to die, are 35% more likely to die within 5 years of their diagnosis than someone who has exactly the same disease and lives in a city. Of course, being diagnosed with cancer is tough for everyone. And if we were to interview someone like John about his experience, he'd say things like he found treatment very tiring, he found the side effects really unpleasant, parking difficult, information overwhelming, and since finishing treatment, worry about cancer coming back quite frightening. But then if we were to ask someone like Bob, he might add that what made things extra complicated for him was that he had to travel for 7.5 hours away from his friends and family and support networks and have his treatment in an unfamiliar city. Like a lot of people in rural Australia, he might be self-employed, so he might be worried about who's going to feed his animals or his stock while he's away. And despite great accommodation facilities run by organisations like Cancer Council, for example, often people faced with this situation find having their treatment away from home very lonely, expensive, and stressful. And I think that this sort of experience is summed up by the quote, "On top of all of this, I've got to try and where am I going to stay? What accommodation? I can't drive the bloody car around. The traffic's too much for me in Adelaide. How am I going to get around? I can't afford taxis." And that's a very common story when we interview these people. We also know that in rural Australia, people tend to have their cancer diagnosed at a later stage, possibly due to differences in access to or the use of screening services. But even if you control for the stage at which someone's cancer is diagnosed, differences in survival outcomes have been shown to continue to exist. We also know that rural cancer survivors are likely to have inferior treatment, possibly to minimise the amount of time that they need to spend away from home. And across many parts of the world, the further someone lives away from a radiotherapy treatment centre, the worse their outcomes likely to be. Again, even if we control or take out of the equation socioeconomic and educational factors. In rural areas, there's also a high incidence of some types of cancers, so bowel cancer, prostate, melanoma, lung, and unknown primary. And we think that that's probably due to differences in lifestyle factors, such as higher rates of smoking in rural areas and also greater sun exposure due to different occupations. And rurality often coincides with lower socioeconomic status, lower levels of education, and there are of course more disadvantaged groups living in rural areas and including more Aboriginal and Torres Strait Islander people. In many parts of rural Australia, as you'd be aware, there's also a lack of GPs, allied health services, clinical trials and specialist follow-ups services. And even when these services actually are physically available, our research has shown us that attitudinal barriers actually often make it very difficult for rural people to access these kind of help, these sorts of help. So it's no surprise that Australian research has shown that rural survivors like Bob are more likely to have unmet supportive care needs than someone who lives in the city. And also research that we've drawn upon from the United States has shown that these rural survivors are also a group who are at risk of poorer mental health, higher levels of psychological distress, more comorbid or other chronic conditions, as well as poorer quality of life. So, armed with all of this knowledge for about the last 8 years now, Ian and I have been working together to answer some research questions that are relevant to overcoming these disparities in this unique group. And we're just going to tell you about a few of these research questions that we've sought to answer. The first question I set out to explore in this area with Ian's help was when I started my PhD. And the question we asked was, what were the key issues associated with the provision of supportive care to rural cancer survivors? And when we talk about supportive care or psychosocial services, we really meant anything from specialist psychiatry or psychology services designed for people who have cancer, all the way through to cancer support groups and supported accommodation facilities such as Greenhill Lodge or Flinders Lodge as well. And what we found from doing these interviews was all of these sorts of support services were really highly valued by these rural cancer survivors who'd access them. And these people told us that they really valued not only support from their family and friends, but the professional support was also very valuable. But accessing the professional support for these rural patients was particularly difficult. And the most dominant barrier, the thing that almost all of the people we spoke to mentioned, was that they just didn't know about these services early enough. And there was a specific lack of information on services that were relevant to rural people. So a lot of the information just wasn't geared up for them. The consensus was that this lack of information was particularly bad when they were first diagnosed with treatment with cancer and starting their treatment. So that led us to the second question, and that was, could a website designed with rural cancer survivors be acceptable to other rural cancer survivors and their supporters? And could it reduce feelings of distress, perceived isolation, and make them feel more motivated and confident to leave home and come to Adelaide or their larger treatment centre to access support and treatment? So to develop this website, we used what's called participatory action research. And very simply, use this approach, you just get people together who are experiencing a problem, you figure out with them what's going on as a group, and then you do something about it. So the people pictured here, as well as others, all identified what sorts of information did they specifically wish that they had been given at the start of their experience with cancer. And then they worked with us to plan out how best to present this information in ways that would be most useful and appropriate to other people who are unlucky enough to be following in their footsteps. When we were developing this resource, we also drew upon a number of behaviour change techniques as well as psychological therapy techniques that previous research had shown was useful. So, for example, we also provided information on others' approval about using support services by placing quotes around the website to try and tackle stigma that people might have about accessing any kind of psychological help. We also demonstrated healthy or useful behaviours by incorporating videos of people like John from Broken Hill. And people like John are on this website modelling behaviour that other patients need to do when they're first diagnosed. So John takes people on a tour of the radiotherapy department and also shows them what they're likely to face when they turn up for chemotherapy on their first day to hopefully make them feel a whole lot less overwhelmed. So pleasingly, the answer to our question about whether the website could be acceptable to other rural cancer survivors and whether it could reduce their feelings of distress and isolation and make them feel more motivated and confident to access treatment was yes. And we had over 32,000 visits to the website in the first 3 years of its operation. And 95% of our participants said they thought the website was necessary. For those of whom it was relevant, over 70% said it made them feel less isolated, over 50% said it made them feel less distressed, and about 65% said it made them more motivated to seek support services, and most pleasingly, over 76% of users for whom it was relevant said it made them more confident and motivated to travel to town to access medical treatment. So we were very pleased in particular with that last result. So now Cancer Council manages the site. We only received two bits of negative feedback. The first one was that people wanted more videos. They really loved the videos, particularly featuring characters like John. And they also told us that they'd like more information on how people could cope when they'd finished cancer treatment and returned home, because that's a time when rural people in particular often feel quite isolated. So this is something that we're in the process of addressing. But another outcome from this study was that many of the volunteers who we involved in the development of the website felt very empowered through their involvement, which is something that we were really proud of. So sadly, John, pictured here, who featured in the videos, died about 2 months before the final version of the website went live. But this is what his daughter had to say to their local newspaper about his involvement. She said, even when he knew his personal battle was coming to an end, he was determined to leave a legacy for others and help prepare them for the battle ahead and hopefully increase their chances of beating the disease. He His family and friends will draw comfort from the knowledge that his message will continue to be a great support for other cancer sufferers. Another question we've asked is whether there are any differences in the mental health, the physical health, or the levels of engagement in behaviour that would reduce the chance of cancer reoccurring between rural and urban cancer survivors. So, as I mentioned earlier, there's evidence that rural survivors in the United States have lower quality of life and higher levels of psychological distress and more comorbidities than their urban counterparts. But until recently, no one had actually examined this issue in Australia. So with a team at Flinders, to examine that question, we looked at data from about 4,500 South Australians with a history of cancer. And what we found was that rural South Australian cancer survivors are more likely than urban cancer survivors to be obese, to not do any physical activity at all, to have diabetes, and also to have a lifetime risk of alcohol-related harm. But interestingly, these differences actually disappeared when we made adjustments for socioeconomic disadvantage. Rural South Australians are actually found to be less likely to report high levels of distress and more likely to report high levels of trust in their communities. They were more likely to have had to travel over 100 kilometres for treatment, as you would expect. But they were no more likely to experience all of these things. Of course, this doesn't mean that these issues don't need addressing in both groups of survivors. We found very high rates of diabetes and cardiovascular disease in both groups, and we were surprised to find that in both rural and urban cancer survivors, 8% still smoke, over a quarter don't engage in any physical activity at all, more than 85% don't eat enough vegetables, and over 50% don't eat enough fruit. So we certainly have a lot more work to be doing in educating and assisting cancer survivors to engage in behaviour that will reduce their chance of cancer coming back, as well as minimising the side effects of their treatment. So the most surprising finding from our analysis of the differences between the two groups was that the rural survivors didn't have poorer mental health outcomes, which contrasts with the American findings. Another question we've asked, and this time from a slightly different angle, is what do rural cancer survivors and their carers perceive as their key challenges post-treatment? So to answer this one, we interviewed 22 rural cancer survivors and carers across a couple of years ago, and we found that the first thing they were most likely to tell us is that when treatment's over, it's not all over. And they had a number of long-term side effects and new health and emotional issues to deal with, for example, fatigue and worry about cancer coming back. The second most common theme we found was the lack of faith in local medical care to help them address all of these post-treatment issues. And the third issue was the great frustration they experienced with having to return back to metropolitan centres all of the time for ongoing cancer surveillance and follow-up care. So we then went on to ask them how they would like these issues to be addressed. And some of the things that came out of that was they said that they were very open to new forms of support. They made it clear that internet-based interventions would help some people, but not all people. They highlighted that continuity of care was really important to them, so they didn't want to be talking to or repeating their story, talking to someone different each time. Interestingly, nurses seem to be a profession that they would feel comfortable in seeking support from. They said that peer support videos, so videos of other people like them who'd been through cancer experiences, would help them make them feel perhaps less lonely. And they also highlighted the need for more widespread use of the teleoncology video conferencing network. And that's actually something that Ian was involved in establishing about 25 years ago. And people said that if this is something that was utilised more and their doctors prioritised using, it could save them lots and lots of trips back to town for checkups. So based upon this feedback, Ian and I have been busy...
We've been on a journey into rural Australia, talking with country people who've been affected by cancer.
People have opened up to us and shared their most difficult experiences with cancer, which is an inspiring way of country people supporting each other.
Oh, the hardest part was leaving home, leaving everything behind and coming down here, don't know if you're going to get back.
I even made a trip out to the cemetery there one day and thought, where the hell am I going to get buried? You know, that's the feeling that was there.
The loss of Andy was tremendous, and thought perhaps didn't want to go on. I was used to being there with him.
People have also told us things they wish they knew earlier and given us pieces of practical advice that they hope will be of benefit to you.
Well, the advice, if you've done that cancer treatment, is try to get into the cancer lodges.
I think that gives you the idea. So what we've done is create a YouTube channel. Ian's actually going to play one of the videos for you later, so that's probably enough anyway. And there's a series of about 20 different video clips like this that rural people who feel that generic cancer materials don't necessarily fit with their needs or recognise their challenges, that this is a place where they can come and hear the stories of people like them. And we've carefully constructed them so that they gently encourage people to adopt healthy behaviours that will reduce their chance of cancer reoccurring. And we also hope that it will overcome some of the barriers to accessing optimal cancer treatment. So people like John talking about how easy it is once you know where to stay and the facilities that are available at places like Cancer Council. Just going to have to skip past this. There we go. So we're actually partway through evaluating this resource at the moment, and the response has been really positive. We actually entered some of these films in a film competition, which was associated with the World Rural Health Conference in New Delhi a few months ago. And we were excited that we did win a prize for our hard work. And so all the country people who generously told their stories were very excited to be able to tell their friends that they'd been featured in Bollywood. But I'm just going to finish by telling you a little bit about some of the things that I learnt about while I was visiting India, the UK, the Netherlands, Canada and the US on a 9-week Churchill Fellowship. So the purpose of this fellowship was to learn about strategies or systems that were being used elsewhere that may help Australians to access optimal cancer treatment and adopt healthier lifestyles during and after cancer treatment so that they can better manage treatment side effects and reduce their chance of cancer reoccurring. And I had a specific focus on learning about strategies that would be of interest or and of benefit to people living in rural areas. So when I started this trip, I must admit, I had a bit of a simplistic idea about how I might kind of address some of these issues. I thought that I'd go to the World Rural Health Conference in New Delhi and I'd get some feedback on our videos and learn from people with similar interests. And then I thought I'd go to Canada and learn about the accommodation facilities that they had developed there, which many of them are newer than ours. And I thought maybe if we could make our accommodation facilities in Adelaide more enticing, that would help get our country patients to treatment. And then I thought I'd go to the Netherlands and talk to some of the developers of online interventions that have been shown to be effective at helping cancer patients and survivors when they've finished treatment address all of the post-treatment issues that they experience. And I thought I'd try and convince some of them to let us copy them and translate them and test them out here. And then my plan was to go to the southern states of America and learn about some of the face-to-face interventions that they've developed in close consultation with rural people as well as other groups who are difficult to engage in mainstream services. But of course, the more you know, the more you realise you don't know. And those things didn't really end up being the entire focus of my trip. I ended up taking away a lot of other things as well. But what I took from my time in India was the great potential to increase the reach and quality of healthcare in rural areas with technology. And I was quite amazed by the particular potential in places like India, where their adoption of technology is, you know, quite incredible. And I think it all has the opportunity to help them bridge the gaps and make progress far quicker than we perhaps could have imagined 10 years ago. Something else that really struck me at this conference was the importance of training medical students in rural areas so that they're willing and able to actually go and work in rural areas in the future. And the problem with getting general practitioners to work in rural areas seems to be a worldwide problem. But there are lots of clever strategies being tested out around the place to try and address that issue. I know it sounds a bit corny, but another thing that really struck me was that there really is a lot more that unites us than divides us in addressing these sorts of rural health issues. And I was quite amazed when I was speaking to doctors from Wales and Scotland and they were describing the kinds of disparities in cancer outcomes that they see and how the attitudinal barriers and things to getting those people to access treatment were very similar to the sorts of attitudinal barriers and issues that we would hear if we were speaking to rural cancer survivors in Australia. And something else that became very clear was that when listening to those people who had successfully implemented strategies to overcome these rural health issues, it's really important that any systems or strategies that are put in place need to be developed in very close consultation with rural people themselves. Otherwise, they just won't be owned and have an impact and be adopted by those rural communities. And I think that's something that we actually did quite successfully with the Country Cancer Support website, and it's something that is going to continue to be a great priority for us in any work we do going forward. Visiting India, I guess, was also a good reminder about how lucky we are in places like countries like Australia. So I had the opportunity to visit what they called a Mahalla clinic. So Mahalla in Hindi means community or neighbourhood. And this was actually, they said it was a relatively new kind of concept to have these primary healthcare clinics in these communities. And this is actually, these photos are taken in the middle of Delhi, and that we hopped off a bus and we walked through this sort of paddock with all these animals and rubbish everywhere. And they didn't even realise that it was quite confronting for us to see that. But then when we arrived, you can see that's me standing out the front. There wasn't a sign or anything. It was all very casual. And you can see from the man with the iPad that what happens at these clinics is when a patient arrives, that man's standing there and he takes their photo. Then the patient goes in and sees the doctor. The doctor hands the person whatever medication they need and they're out the door. And this particular doctor told us that the government pays him to see at least 200 patients between 8 a.m. and 2 p.m. And then if he chooses to stay beyond that, he's given further incentives by the government. So on average, he said he'd see about 300 patients a day. So it really was quite amazing. And it became apparent that first I was quite impressed. They were taking everyone's photos with the iPad and using this technology, but then I realised that the only reason they were taking the photos was so that they could report back to the government how many patients they'd seen, and there was absolutely no medical records or any worries about anything like that. In the UK, I visited the Churchill Museum, which was great, and I was reminded about the importance of leadership skills. And then I went to Macmillan, which is the UK's big cancer charity. And there I learnt quite a lot about an approach that they're using. And that is they have nurses situated in primary healthcare clinics. And these nurses help cancer survivors who finish their treatment work out what their post-treatment goals are. And then they help them kind of reach them. Often they're around exercise, for example. By firstly ensuring they've got all the information they need on the topic, and then they sort of take them to the next level about eliciting personal resources or strategies that might have helped them in the past to overcome challenges to achieving that goal. And then if they can still see the person struggling, then they might try and bring in their social networks to help them get on track with those goals. And then if they're still struggling, they might bring in technology, a Fitbit or an app or something. And then if all of that doesn't work, then they bring in face-to-face services such as an exercise physiologist or something. So I think that kind of model, you know, the goal-directed model where patients actually get to choose what it is that they want to focus on, what's important to them, would fit quite well with the, you know, preferences expressed by the people that we've spoken to in our research. And in particular, I think I like the fact that this was nurses who were leading this kind of work because, as I said earlier, in our rural communities, nurses are a profession that people seem to be quite keen to engage with. And in rural areas where access to GPs is very limited, perhaps they're actually underutilising the skills of, you know, other professions. Perhaps we could be using nurses to do these sorts of things. When I went to the Netherlands, I found that, yes, there were lots of online interventions or online programs that would be useful for cancer survivors in Australia, and they'd been effective at reducing distress. And these people were very willing to let us trial them out in Australia. But what I learnt from them was that developing all these interventions isn't really enough, and they're sort of about 5 years further down the track than we are, and they're finding they've got lots of these great programs, but beyond funding cycles, a lot of them just disappear. So I think in establishing networks or a system or a depository, a place for all of these great programs to live in the long term, is a really important step so that we don't waste lots of resources and then end up not having things that are available to the public in the long term, which seems to be happening there. Something else I think they do really well in the Netherlands is to reduce duplication of cancer information and cancer-related directories and databases to make it really easy for patients to find the information they need and to keep all of this information up to date. So they have quite a clever system whereby any cancer organisation or cancer treatment centre that wants to have cancer-related information on their website, they can have their own website, but the information on that website is actually populated by a central organisation that is very well regulated and very up to date with everything. So that means that if information on a service changes or a recommendation about a treatment or a way to manage a side effects changes, that only needs to be updated in this one central place, and all the other websites are updated automatically. So they've found that it actually saves organisations a huge amount of money, and it of course makes things a whole lot less confusing for people affected by cancer who we do here, you know, get quite frustrated when they end up with conflicting information. I then went on to Alberta in Canada, which is a very large state there with a large rural population. And I learnt about the way that they're delivering chemotherapy really close to people's homes across that very vast state. So they told me about how they'd managed to overcome any concerns about transporting drugs at the right temperature with, you know, quite simple strategies with packaging and monitoring of temperatures during transport. They'd overcome challenges around the lack of expertise of doctors or nurses in rural communities by setting up programs where those rural professionals would visit the larger treatment centres and develop relationships so that they could all trust each other and be confident that the care being delivered remotely was of high quality. And they'd also overcome a lot of logistical challenges by using what they call patient navigators. In Canada, these were actually nurses, and these were people who guided patients from the time of diagnosis throughout their cancer journey with all of the logistical things that we often hear people, particularly who have to travel for treatment, get very frustrated by. And they'd found that since implementing this patient navigator system, the costs of running their services had decreased a lot. But most importantly, the satisfaction with care had really improved quite remarkably. So everyone ended up happier in the end. Another initiative I learned about in Canada was called the Better Program, whereby they have what they call prevention practitioners situated in primary health care, so in GP clinics. And these are people who perform kind of a similar role to those people I described that Macmillan use in the UK. But they help people with the prevention and management of all chronic conditions. So I think that kind of model may be useful, particularly in rural areas where you know, the volume of cancer patients wouldn't be high enough. And another thing I learnt in Canada that is that Australians who can't even play ice skate shouldn't try and play ice hockey. And I had quite an accident, but I did end up relatively lucky in that I only sprained my wrist. I didn't actually break it. And just finally, in the US, I was really pleased to see that their National Cancer Institute has made reducing disparities in outcomes between rural and urban populations a really big priority, and they're pouring a huge amount of money into understanding why these differences exist, as well as identifying strategies that can help overcome the issues. I also was pleased to learn about the American Cancer Society's online program called Springboard Beyond Cancer, which is something that I think people affected by cancer in Australia could benefit from. And the last thing I wanted to mention was a program I learned about called Harvest for Health, whereby they pair people up who have just finished their cancer treatment with a volunteer from the community, and together they build a vegetable garden. So they've found that through this very simple intervention, they can improve cancer survivors' physical strength, the amount of physical activity they do, the number of vegetables they eat, and of course their mental health, and in doing all of that, reduce their chance of cancer coming back. So that's something that we're quite keen to test out here, and if any of you have ideas about how we could do that, I'd be pleased to speak to you about them. So addressing these issues is more complicated than I realised at first, but Ian and I will certainly keep trying. And I'll just leave you with these quotes that show that a lot of country people do really feel forgotten or perhaps even neglected, and they're often quite surprised that people like us are trying quite hard to understand their needs and look out for their interests. So as one rural cancer survivor said, the rules are made in the city and then they try and stamp them on you in the country, and they just don't work and they make things worse and they make things harder. So I guess our job is to prove this lady wrong. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Kate, for a very interesting presentation. We do have a few moments to answer any questions. So there's a couple of roving microphones that will be coming round. And Kate, if I can ask you to repeat the question before you answer it.
Thank you. Can you hear me?
Yes.
Yeah. A couple of brief questions and a suggestion for the vegetable garden. The patient navigator, given the stress that you put on continuity, do you get a patient navigator who follows right through with you? That's good.
Yeah.
And then the prevention practitioner, the training for that, is that like a nurse practitioner sort of training on top?
Good question. So the first one, is the patient navigator a consistent person throughout the whole of treatment? Ideally, I saw different models, different places I went, but in Canada they were actually nurses who were working as these patient navigators, whereas in some parts in the US where I visited, they were actually lay navigators. Mm-hmm. So they had actually decided that it was better for people not to have a focus on the these navigators not to have a focus on the clinical care,
yep,
and instead more focus on the logistical issues.
Yep.
In both settings, I think, yeah, they were ideally the same person, but I wouldn't be sure that that would be the case every time.
Uh-huh.
And the second question was...
prevention practitioner's training.
Yeah. So no, I don't think that these were people who were as highly skilled as a nurse practitioner. I think they, which in Australia is, you know, high level of training, isn't it? No, I think they were just, well, not just, but they were registered nurses who'd had, I don't think it was all that extensive training, maybe even just a couple of weeks of training. And it was all around motivational interviewing, and I think they were experienced nurses, so they already knew the local services and they already knew a lot about the healthcare system. So it was just a matter of delivering this kind of package of information in a particular way that was similar across various sites, so that they could do the research on it. But again, these people, they were very willing for us to take any of their ideas and you know, try and test out their models here. So.
Yeah. And my suggestion, re the vegetable gardens, have you approached Gardening Australia? They have volunteers for so many programs.
Really?
They feature it on TV for you.
Oh, excellent.
You'd get a whole load of input from them.
Oh, great.
It's just what they'd love to be associated
with.
Oh,
excellent. Well, thank you for that suggestion about Gardening Australia. That's very useful. Yeah. Thank you.
Hello. It's probably a two-pronged question, particularly with the very remote areas. There was mention of eating healthy food. Now, what is the problem, or are there problems with access to fresh fruit and vegetables? And I guess sort of following on from that, if it's in a partnership of a male-female, in the rural areas, is it more likely that the female is the cook, that sort of thing with that sort of gender divide? And if it's the female who's had the treatment and is suffering from extreme fatigue, how will that couple manage, and how will she receive the good nutrition? There's problems there. Has that been looked at all?
No, I think you're right. There certainly are challenges with getting fresh fruit and vegetables into some of these more remote areas. I know as a little kid, when we came down from the farm, most kids would want to go to a toy shop, but we just wanted to go to the fruit and veg shop and have some strawberries or something. So, it is a big problem. I think in terms of, you know, some of the cancer patients that we've spoken to that I've spoken to over the years have said another thing is when they're feeling sick, you know, they don't have takeaway that they could just go and get an easy meal, pick an easy meal up from the shop. So there are challenges around those issues. But I think the great thing about rural communities is that people really do help each other, and I think the strong sense of community and the trust of your neighbour that came through in one of our studies, the higher levels of trust in the rural areas, might explain why our outcomes with mental health aren't poorer in rural areas. So in rural areas there aren't the professional support services, but that community support is really valuable. So I think, well, I hope that those people who can't access takeaway and might have challenges in terms of accessing fresh food, I think country people do quite a good job of looking after each other and delivering things where they can. But yeah, no, there's lots of challenges out there. Hmm. Yeah, the suggestion was raised vegetable gardens. Yes. Raised beds would be better. Yes, and that's right. That they actually gave, in America, they gave people the option of raised or low. Oh, you had, right, good. Yeah. And over there, yes.
On ABC TV about a few months ago, I saw a show where they actually had a portable chemotherapy radiography machine going to a person's home. And this is a young lad, and he's able to work on his car and live his normal life, whereas we've got friends where constantly they're disrupted, having to go to hospital, actually monthly or, you know, every so often. And it's just, wouldn't be, is there any progression with more availability of mobile?
Yeah, that's a good question. I have heard about it being available in South Australia, and I might actually leave it to Ian to talk about. I think he... he probably knows more about that one than I do.
Just a quick answer to that one, because we tried it when I was at the Royal Adelaide, and in fact Queen Elizabeth did it for a lot longer. The patients love it when you send a chemotherapy nurse out to give the chemotherapy. The problem is she could or he could treat five or six patients more by staying and having the patients come to them. So in a state system, it just wasn't cost effective. So if we could make it more cost effective, it's certainly something that eases the burden on patients.
Does location and isolation have any difference in patient response to treatment and so on? If you are closer, say, to Mount Gambier than you are to Adelaide, if the treatment is in Mount Gambier, does that have any bearing on a patient's reception and so on?
Ian Martin, he looks like he's got an answer for this one too.
So if you take a map of Australia and you look at the rurality, the distance from the big cities, the survival actually gets worse as you go further because of sometimes delays in diagnosis, because you can't have a CAT scan in the middle of the bush, that sort of thing. So you keep coming to the city, and then there are delays in scheduling treatments and so on. So where there are centres, and there are, you know, Mount Gambier and Whyalla are good examples where there are visiting oncologists to see patients and give chemotherapy, and the treatment and the outcomes will be just the same. But it's the other things of being diagnosed late and it being more difficult to do everything, all the diagnosis and the treatment together. And that's why what we want to do by some of this is not only provide better support, but actually make that difference in survival disappear if we can, because that's the most damning thing about it.
Hi, Kate. You were talking about having nurses doing a lot more things, and also about training for doctors to work in the country. And I was wondering, is there enough nurses to be able to have these additional roles for them in the country? And is there perhaps a role for cancer patients themselves to be able to work with the local services or interested lay people and help build that capacity within the community, using the experience of the people that have been through it?
Yeah, that's a really good question. I think using the experiences of people who've been through it is very powerful, and that's why, you know, Ian and I were well aware that if we stood up and made videos telling people to exercise and eat healthy, they weren't going to listen to us. But if we had the stories of people who'd actually lived through it, then they'd be far more persuasive. So, yeah, I think it's a good idea to be able to capitalise on those very valuable experiences. But to be honest, it's not something that I'd thought a whole lot about, and I'd be pleased to speak to you and Cancer Voices about that. Thank you.
Thank you. I realise this is really stretching you, but having worked with migrants in the Western area in my previous mental health work, I really wonder about using migrants and refugees and inducement to go country to train them for some of these things, even cooking food and takeaways. There are a lot of communities with groups of migrants there already. You could use people who have training already. I realise it's difficult because of government policy, but I really wonder whether that would be a way, again, to increase the staff that you need.
Yeah. Well, that's another really interesting suggestion that I hadn't thought of, so thank you. Yeah.
You were talking about the fruit and vegetables access. Mm. Well, on Catalyst a few weeks ago, they had a show about, they had a type of container thing that they actually grew fruit and vegetables hydroponically. Would that be of any use?
Right, possibly. Another good idea. Thank you.
Yes.
That's right, you are full of good ideas. Thank you all.
Just a lot of your stuff you talk about is on computer. I mean, in the country, sometimes they don't have as good as Wi-Fi access, or with the ageing population, I mean, coming up, it'll be quite good. But some people don't even know how to turn the computer on, you know, like my dad's early 70s, 75. He doesn't have access to a computer. He has no understanding. So is there other forms? A lot of it you were talking about, you know, to look on sites and things like that, but is there other written material that they can access that you provide, or?
Yeah, I think that's an important point, and it, you know, it's come through with our interviews with rural cancer survivors as well, that, yeah, as they said, it will, these interventions will help some, but not all of us. So, yeah, with the Country Cancer Support website, for example, we made sure that every page could be downloaded as a PDF and printed off really easily and handed out to people. I know Cancer Council distributes a lot of information in hard copy form still. The challenge always is that if we print things, then they go out of date. And keeping information up to date is really important. But I think there'll always be a place for other sorts of interventions other than things that are online, which is why I'm, you know, not just focusing on the websites and things they're doing in the Netherlands. I'm also interested in the interventions they're doing in the southern states of America, where people do have very low levels of education and low levels of access to technology. And some of the work that they're doing is having, you know, far more powerful effects, actually, than these online interventions. So, yeah, I think we've got to be open-minded about all of that.
Thank you for your questions, and thank you again to Kate for a wonderful presentation. We'll now have a short break for refreshments, so do make your way outside and do mind the step, and please return in about 15 minutes to hear from Ian Olver, our second presenter today. Welcome back, everyone. Can you all still hear me at the back? Yes, great, thank you. So just a reminder before we get started again that we would really appreciate you completing the feedback form before the end of today's seminar. There's pens available at the front, and please, once you've filled it in, just pop it into the box here at the front. In particular, we would like your feedback on which day of the week is more convenient for us to hold these, whether it's Thursday or Friday, so please do make a note of your preference on that too. And I also want to highlight that our second speaker today, Professor Ian Olver, is currently part of a crowdfunding initiative. Ian has teamed up with UniSA pain expert Professor Lorimer Moseley, and their plan is to fast-track an intervention for cancer survivors who are struggling with persistent pain. So today is the final day of our push for donations, so please do make sure you've picked up the flyer at the front here about this campaign, and do consider donating whatever you can to support this wonderful cause. So I'm now delighted to welcome our second presenter, Professor Ian Olver. Ian is the director of UniSA's Cancer Research Institute and a professor of translational cancer research. Ian is a renowned oncologist, cancer researcher, and bioethicist, and a regular commentator on cancer issues both in Australia and internationally. Ian's particular research interests include anti-cancer drug studies, symptom control, bioethics, and psycho-oncology. In Ian's presentation today, he will start by illustrating some of the issues that are faced and overcome by rural cancer patients. He will highlight research conducted into the financial toxicity associated with cancer and its treatment, and the challenges of looking after relatives at a distance. Ian will also discuss the barriers to communication about cancer and its treatment, which we hope to overcome by the Aboriginal Cancer Communication Project. Please join me in welcoming Professor Ian Olver.
Well, thank you very much, and given that you all like television, and to follow on from Kate's presentation, I'm going to actually show you an edited version of one of the videos that were made of rural cancer patients, just to show you what sort of advice and how willing they were to share their experience, and it turns out that's very powerful for others, so let's...
My name is Vivani Rusden. I have metastatic breast cancer and bowel cancer. You can't let cancer take over your life. It's part and parcel of what's you, really. But you can't let it be the be-all and end-all. That's the hardest thing to cope with, I think, because if you really were maudlin enough, you would just give into it, which is what I did for 2 years. So for 2 years, I vegetated and did nothing. And in a way, I regret that now, because I probably could have got better sooner. When I say better, I mean more motivated, more willing to go on with life. I'd recommend to others that they educate themselves, however way they can, booklets, the internet, and you need to look at them before you go and you go for treatment, not afterwards. You need to know what might happen before it happens so that you can cope with it, especially if you've got to do all this travelling in between. But you have to be careful. Don't always believe what you read on the internet. You have to eat a healthy diet. And it's especially not easy where I live, because I have to shop for a week at a time. But you need to eat lots of vegetables and fruit. Make sure that you have all the things that go with a rounded diet. And the reason for that is that your body's being bombarded, your cells are being killed, and they need to, the new ones need a healthy diet to keep growing. I just walk 30 minutes a day. If I don't exercise, it affects my energy level and the fatigue that is part of the cancer. It lifts my mood and makes me less anxious and stops me from getting depression. It might wear you out to walk down, do your 30-minute walk and back, but then for the rest of the day you feel better. So it's important that you don't neglect doing those things. Hopefully I will continue to be reasonably able to live my life, reasonably. But there are going to be changes eventually. What they will be, I don't know. A life with cancer can be worth living. I'm having a lovely time right now watching my granddaughters play netball. If I'd given into it two, three years ago, I wouldn't be doing that right now.
So that was, we've got a series of those. They're on YouTube and they cover all sorts of aspects, but they're very persuasive. I mean, that was one where she did talk a lot about diet and exercise, but in a way that made it alluring to actually do those things. So what I wanted to talk about, Kate talked about some of our past projects, and I want to talk about some of our newer projects on things that are causing disparities to rural patients. And I want to talk about financial toxicity. It seems like a bit odd to talk about your finances as being a toxicity, but because of things like high-cost drugs and so on, and because sometimes with a cancer diagnosis you actually lose your job or can't find another job, then they've coined this term financial toxicity to cover that. And then I want to talk about another project we're doing, looking at the challenge of caring for distant relatives, because these days people are very mobile, and with rural patients, you know, the kids might be in the city trying to make decisions about their relatives. And finally, I want to talk to you about communicating cancer, and there's many groups in rural areas and many reasons for having different techniques to communicate. But the one I just wanted to finish off with was communicating cancer to Aboriginal patients. So the financial toxicity is the unintended potential economic harm or damage of having cancer and being treated. And it's got two components. It's the objective component, in other words, what your finances actually are, and the subjective component is how upset you are about what your finances actually are. And But it does result in reducing your quality of life, and it can actually compromise treatment and worsen outcomes, particularly if you're cutting corners because you can't afford the treatment or to go to the doctor. And it not only, of course, impacts on the patient, but their whole household. And when you're faced, when you've either lost your job or you've had to pay out a lot for unregistered cancer treatments that haven't been funded yet, you have to redistribute your finances and try and recover from it. And what we thought was if we could find out more about the best ways of doing that, we'd be able to counsel patients so they didn't have to find out for themselves by sort of trial and error. So financial distress is the reaction to your state of finances. And what sort of extent is this problem? Well, several studies have shown that the prevalence of financial distress in the US ranged from about a quarter to up to about two-thirds of cancer patients that were working age reported some significant downturn in their finances. And we can actually measure that, so people have got objective scores where they ask questions about, A, whether you worry about your finances, and B, how much have you got enough money to do this, that and the other that would be part of your normal living. And it not only affects the period where you're actually being treated, but it can actually have an effect in the long term. So this was a study of long-term survivors, and about a fifth of them reported worrying about their finances and 15% actually being in financial difficulty. If you didn't worry about it and you were just in financial difficulty, they reported you eventually became a stronger person because you got over the thing. But even if you were coping well with the cancer, it didn't necessarily mean that you'd be able to cope well with getting out of financial trouble. There was a study that was actually done in rural Western Australia of 400 patients after a cancer diagnosis, 21 weeks after, and the out-of-pocket expenses were $2,179. That was just in the first 21 weeks after their treatment. Often they spent greater than 10% of their household income on something to do with the cancer, travelling to it, having scans, having treatment, and so on. And it seemed to be worse in terms of your out-of-pocket expense if you were younger, if you lived more remotely. And interestingly enough in this group, because Australia does have the option of private health insurance, it was a little worse if you had private health insurance because, as the Americans say, that you get nickel and dime to death with the gaps. You know, every test has a gap, every x-ray has a gap and so on. So the people that were turning up at the public hospitals and being covered for pretty much everything were fine, but the ones with private health insurance were watching things fritter away, which is, an interesting finding. But what we're interested in is the choices people make because of the financial impact. And the problem is, in the literature, it shows that they don't always make very good choices, and that's why we want to discover what the choices are and discover what the best choices are. Because when you're faced with this, what happens? And some cut back food or make it last longer. Well, it's all right if you're cutting back sort of fancy food, but if you're starting to cut back on staples, that's the problem. Second-hand clothes is probably a sensible thing to do. Turning off the heating during the winter is probably not a sensible thing to do. Socialising less, well, we are social beings, so that's interfering with quality of life. In the literature, you either reduce the spending on the children, or in fact you do all your spending on the children and don't spend anything on yourself, and both of them have sort of consequences for the family. And even not taking holidays or not being able to take holidays, you know, significantly impacts on lifestyle. But the real ones that we were worried about were the number of patients that stop medications because they can't afford to keep paying for them, or particularly in rural patients where the doctor might be a 60-kilometre trip away, stopping paying for the petrol to go to the doctor. So you put up with a side effect or you put up with a symptom, hoping it'll go away and you'll save yourself the trip, so you present late. So they're the sort of things that are happening, and this is why we want to study it. In terms of employment, cancer survivors are about 1.5 times more likely to be unemployed than people with other illnesses, and it seems to be worse if you've got what used to be called the blue-collar jobs rather than the white-collar jobs. But the interesting figure is 30% of previously employed cancer survivors have not returned to work in 5 years. Now, some of them don't want to, which is fine, but some of them, most of them do want to, but they can't get a job again, or they had the sort of job where there aren't light duties, and so there was no substitute job they could do. 70% of patients have had at least a 50% drop of income, and the out-of-pocket medical expenses for cancer patients tend to be 3 times more severe than for people with other chronic diseases. So this is a real problem in cancer. When a group of patients with prostate cancer were asked about their choices for employment, 9% decided against treatment because of cost. They didn't want to have the treatment ruin their chances of a job. 34% just went on with the treatment but struggled financially. They either drew down on their savings or they sold assets like their house or they increased their credit card limit. And one quarter chose to stop work earlier than planned because they just couldn't cope with the cancer and its effects. So in an Australian study that was done with 255 patients from a regional and metropolitan hospital, 63%, so it was a little bit higher than the other study, showed less household income, and this affected their treatment decisions, again, more with patients with private health insurance. And of course, in the era of personalised medicine, where the drugs are becoming very expensive, and until they get onto the PBS, they could be $100,000 or $200,000 per course of treatment. This is becoming more apparent than it was with the old, cheaper cytotoxics. So what we're looking at as well is not only the patients, but the caregivers, because the choices that the caregivers are making, 45% have to reduce their working hours to look after their relatives, 18% quit work altogether, and they actually delayed the care for other family members, about a fifth of them, because they were so busy looking after the person with cancer that the other diagnoses were just put to the side. So it's a really serious problem. Clinicians do have a role in the management of this, trying to use cheaper generic treatments, being very transparent about what the costs are so that you know going in what it's going to cost, helping negotiate with government about things like fair drug reimbursement and cost sharing, but also making clear to patients what the value of a treatment is rather than just its benefits. So, you know, a treatment with a lot of toxicity that's incredibly expensive that will give 6 weeks extra survival may not represent good value. And if you took in terms of value rather than just the 6 weeks extra survival, you'll get a different response to whether that treatment should be started or not. So what we're doing is we want to interview a series of people about this because often patients won't talk to their doctors about it. And in a study looking at this, 50% or so wanted the doctor to do something about it, but only 19% had actually spoken to the doctor about it. But of those 90%, over 50%, the doctor did do something about the overall cost of their treatment. And they're more likely to discuss, as probably you'd recognise, that the worse off you are, the more you are able to discuss it with your doctor. So the preferences of not discussing was they didn't have a financial problem. Some of them think that you get worse care, that they won't give you the best options if you try and put financial barriers on, so they don't want that to happen, so they don't discuss it. Some think the doctor shouldn't have to worry about the finances, somebody else's problem, and some think the doctor has no idea about these things and wouldn't be able to help anyway. But those who did discuss it was because they were in real trouble, or, and this is the important thing, if the doctor raises the issue, it gave the patient permission to discuss and things went better, and others discussed it because of the out-of-pocket expenses were just getting higher and higher. So what we want to do is create a tool to predict household budget adjustments in response to financial shock. And we want to study a group of people. Initially, we're going to do it in a pilot study with rural patients who are to find out what strategies they would use if they suffered from some tremendous financial shock. Now, it's very similar to going through a bushfire or your house being flooded or whatever. You lose a lot up front and then you've got to recover. But if we can find out the best strategies, then we can develop a tool to help patients that are just coming into it for the first time to work their way through it. And we do this by using what they call discrete choice experiments, where you get a whole lot of people to talk about all the things that could be done, and then you pair them up and get them to say, well, would you do this one ahead of that? And if you do that enough times, you eventually get a list of what the best things are down to what the worst things are, and we can develop our counselling on that. So that's the current project to deal with that patient in rural issues. Now, the second study I just wanted to talk about is the challenges and decisions faced by children who need to manage the care of elderly patients at a distance. And as our society becomes more mobile, your kids are all over the place. I've got one in New York, one in Sydney, and one in Adelaide. So although it's lovely to travel, I mean, I'm not too not sure about my choices when I get old and have to get looked after. But the point was, this happens quite a lot, and it may be that they're international, it may be that they're interstate, or they're just rural parents with urban kids. And so it's an increasing problem, and we know that there are frustrations when you have to try and manage your parent at a distance, make the significant decisions, but we also know that sometimes the patient themselves, the elderly patient, are not really satisfied with the decisions made, or the health system isn't allowing them to have the options that they'd like. So we want to find out what these problems are so that, again, we can both counsel the sons and daughters about the best ways to cope, but also talk to the health system about the way that it should reorganise itself to make it easier. So that's the name of the study, and we hope to uncover the trade-offs that need to be made to get the best outcomes for both. Oh, there we are. So the last topic I want to talk about is communication, because we've talked about, you know, how do you communicate if you're not on the internet? But we have groups, and particularly in rural areas, we have groups of Aboriginal patients, and we wanted to address the question of, you know, how do you explain cancer and its treatment to an Aboriginal patient so that they understand it? So we're about to start a study where we're going to ask the Aboriginal patients, and we're going to ask their doctors, what explanation of cancer, actually, what it was that made the penny drop. So, for example, you know, I didn't understand what cancer is until the doctor said it's like a tree with spreading branches or something like that. And so if we can, if we can discover what actually works from the people that are doing it all the time, or the patients that finally understood what their cancer and treatment was all about, then we'll be able to develop education programs for doctors, and they won't have to learn from scratch. And I actually used to do a clinic in Alice Springs, and I had to learn from scratch how to talk to Aboriginal patients about cancer. And I eventually got there, but it took a long time of miscommunication. And just to show you how differently people can think, I don't know if you... This is a painting that I have that was given to me by this Aboriginal artist who was actually a health worker in Alice Springs and an artist. And she's painted a picture. And that is actually my Alice Springs clinic. as seen by her. And what you see there is a group of tables, five tables with chairs around them, with Aboriginal and white doctors, and so Aboriginal patients and doctors sitting around discussing their illness, as we used to do in clinic. And the greenery is the traditional Aboriginal medicines that they would think would work for this type of thing. And the circles at the top and bottom in the middle are actually the depiction she had of radiotherapy and chemotherapy. And on the side where you've got a couple of horseshoes with on their side, they were the Nunkaris. They're the traditional Aboriginal healers. And finally, quite discordant in an Aboriginal dot painting were these two things. Does anyone recognise them? They are the dosette boxes we used to give them their pills in so that they could count them out every day. So this is a perfectly good depiction of my clinic in Alice Springs, but it's quite different from the way I would have drawn it or thought about it and so on. And that's the challenge we're faced with when we're dealing with cultures and people different from our background. How do we explain things that we understand in a way that they would? Because, for example, there are some Aboriginal people that believe that cancer is payback for some event with a relative. So surgery, chemotherapy and radiotherapy seems a very peculiar way of dealing with that situation. So that's the final of the studies that I wanted to talk to you about today in terms of us trying to remedy that problem so that everyone that's faced with going into rural areas or going up to Alice Springs and doing a clinic doesn't have to start from scratch, because we can be taught these things and make a better fist of it if we can use all the experience that's out there already from the patients and their carers and doctors. So I'm happy to take questions.
Thank you, Ian. Do pop your hand up if you have a question.
I was just wondering, with your financial toxicity and the tool that you're hoping to develop, would you see doctors going on that with that as usual, or do financial counsellors already deal with that, or is that something that you would look at social workers taking over? There are all those sorts of options for financial counselling.
Yeah. Look, that's a good point, and we think it could be useful across the board, so that there are financial counsellors in banks, for example. I know that not too popular at the moment, but nonetheless, there are people that offer sort of financial advice to people. So we think the tool could be equally applicable to those as to social workers. I think the thing with the doctor is not so much to get involved in solving the problem, but to understand that the problem exists, give the patient the chance to express the problem, but also to realise that there are things they can do about minimising the cost. For example, with good collaboration with a rural GP, you don't have to keep seeing the follow-up patients all the time, as often as we used to, for example. Mm-hmm. If you've got good communication, or you have a telemedicine link, you can actually leave the patient at home and still do a consultation. So we want the doctors is really an awareness exercise so they can start thinking about how to reduce the costs.
May I ask if doctors are sufficiently educated in their medical undergraduate times to do that?
Well,
or is it something that as you progress in oncology, you develop that sensitivity?
Look, I think the issue is this is a relatively new issue. Mm-hmm. When I started as an intern at the Alfred in Melbourne many, many years ago, it was actually 1977, Money was never an object. You could use whatever treatment you liked and the state would pay for it, mainly because none of the treatments were all that expensive relatively. So this is an emerging problem, and now we have these very high cost drugs. Between the time they're known to be effective and the time they get on the pharmaceutical benefits scheme, there can be a couple of years of, and some of them require a test to see if your tumour has the right marker to be treated. So that's several hundred dollars as well. So it's finally come to a head because of these really high cost drugs. The problem of losing your job has always been an issue. And so I think it's a relatively new thing, but it's just like, it's only been in the last perhaps 15, 20 years that medical students have been taught communication skills like end of life discussions and so on. So it's one of those things you add into the mix as it becomes a problem.
Ian, about the cultural differences and understandings of cancer, there's often in not just Aboriginal communities but also some Asian communities around a stigma and a silence about cancer where people in the communities don't talk about it, so people feel really isolated with cancer. Was that sort of thing coming out in your research, and are there ways to try and help the community to realise that cancer isn't contagious and that there are ways they can sort of help each other out?
Well, one of the times where it came out specifically, not in our research but in the general consciousness, was when the bowel screening program started up in Australia, and the government on your birthday would say, "Happy birthday, here's a bowel screening kit," as long as you'd turned 50 and were under 75. And every 2 years, by the time we get to 2020, this will keep happening every couple of years. And it was, you know, sent in an ordinary package and so on. But if it went to an Aboriginal community, then everyone knew that this package was going to him and they were testing him for cancer. And, you know, didn't want everyone to know that, particularly returning it, because of it was a culturally insensitive way of doing it. So two things happened. One was that it was discovered that the kits actually went off in the heat, so you can't send them up there in the, up to remote places in the summer anyway, so people don't get it on their birthday if they live in certain areas. But the other thing was, it was probably better to send it to the Aboriginal health worker in the local clinic to, you know, do this under supervision with the confidentiality and so on. So, it is a problem, and there are barriers with the stigma of cancer that have to be overcome as well. You've got to have the right environment, you've got to have the knowledge the understanding of the other person. It doesn't matter if it's an Aboriginal culture or culturally and linguistically diverse culture, the understanding of what it is, what treatments are likely to be accepted, and then explain it in a way that they can understand it. When I first went to Darwin, it was actually to talk to the Darwin people about setting up a telemedicine link between Adelaide and Darwin back in 1995, and I was doing a ward run with them, and there was an Aboriginal patient there that needed to be treated for liver cancer. And in those days, we used to use doxorubicin, and it had about a 25% response rate. And they said, "Oh, go and tell that guy that, you know, we need to use doxorubicin." Now, I knew that I couldn't go and tell him that, you know, there was a 25% chance that he was going to respond. So I thought I'd be cleverer than that. So I went to him and I said, "Look, you know, you've got this thing. We've got a drug. If I take four men and I give them all the drug, one gets better." And he looked at me and he said, "What are their names?" And I realised that this guy thought I was going to tell him a story, and I'd already missed out something really important. We weren't even on the same planet when it came to communicating, and it was that sort of experience that that shows how far we have to go to make treatment available. And we're talking about rural disparities. This is just an example of a disparity that's about communication.
Hello, Professor Olver. Hello. Some years ago, I worked on C6 at the old RA, which, of course, was one of the chemotherapy wards. And I remember very vividly the Aboriginal people who would be flown in from remote communities. I'm just wondering if there's been any change in the preparation or the support, if it's still happening and they're still being brought down here, because they were very isolated, not just from family and community, but from their land. And they seem to be very sad. I found it very sad.
Look, it's a very good point. The issue, there's been a lot of attempts to do things. Most hospitals now have Aboriginal health workers and so on. But in South Australia, if you're flown down from the Northern Territory, which often happens, and your Aboriginal liaison officer is local, you don't even speak the same language. Now, we have actually in the past, even when I was practicing, we've used telemedicine to get someone from home to sort of translate, but that's fairly clunky. You can't do that all day, every day, so it was just intermittent. But it is a real problem. I think things are improving, but they've still got a long way to go. And some people with experience, get better at it. I'll tell another story. I was doing a ward run one Saturday morning, and on the Saturday mornings, you don't have the big ward runs, and I just had my nurse and the intern with me, and the intern was a woman, and so was the nurse, and we went to see an Aboriginal patient who I just met for the first time the day before, and we'd had a chat, and he rolled himself up into a little ball and just wouldn't even look at me, and as I was standing there, the nurse and the intern pulled the curtains, and the guy sat on the side of the bed and spoke to me though nothing had happened, and he asked me, the questions he wanted to ask and so on. When I got to the next bed, it had an opal miner from Coober Pedy in the bed, and he said to me, the nurse indicated that this guy had said, look, this fellow won't talk to the doctor while there are women present about his body. So I told them, to move out of there, and that's why things went better. So, you've got to learn those lessons. And the interesting thing is, so I said to him, well, thank you, that was very helpful. And he looked at me and said, some of us know some things and some of us know others. And when I was writing a paper later on communication, I used that as the title of the paper because it's so apt. So the answer is it's improving, but it's nowhere near where we need to be.
Professor, I was interested to read in the literature we've been given that you're hoping to develop an online tool to teach people about new understanding of pain and yes. How to manage it. And just how would that work?
Okay, so about 40% of patients that are long-term survivors will have at least some moderate pain, probably 10 to 15% it'll be quite severe. And if you've got chronic pain, as opposed to acute pain after an operation or something, taking medication can be really problematic because you get side effects from the medication. I mean, opiates, morphine makes you a bit nauseated, it makes you constipated, it can dull your consciousness a bit, it can give you itch. There's a whole lot of side effects of drugs like that. And they don't often work particularly well. And the interesting thing that's been discovered about chronic pain is in a case of someone who's had been treated for cancer, the cancer caused the pain in the first place by putting pressure on a nerve or something like that. The cancer's gone away and yet you still feel the pain. And that's because a pathway got created that tells you the pain's still there. So you still perceive the pain, but there's actually no pain stimulus left. And Lorimer Moseley, who's a physio and a bit of a psychologist to boot, has been working with chronic pain, not in cancer, but in other diseases like chronic back pain. And he's found that he's able to re-educate people's perception of pain so that they can no longer you know, need suffer from the pain because they he uses all sorts of tricks to do it, but they learn that the pain doesn't sort of actually exist anymore. The stimulus doesn't exist and the pain actually slowly abates. So we thought, I wonder whether this will work in cancer, and that's what we're doing at the moment, or what we plan to do. Why might it not work in cancer? Well, one of the reasons it may not work is that unlike someone with chronic back pain, there's always a fear, and it might be reality, that the pain is due to the cancer coming back, you see. So we may not be able to necessarily re-educate people about the perception of pain because, you know, it might be something real and their fear of recurrence may overcome any attempts to educate. But we're basically going to use tried and true tools that he's used in other types of chronic pain to apply to cancer. And if it worked, it would be a non-pharmacological way of dealing with a large number of cancer survivors whose quality of life has been compromised by having pain despite the fact their cancer went away years ago. So that's the nature of the study.
May I ask some really specific questions about funding and financial toxicity? Yep. Given that the agricultural lifestyle is such a risk, viz. The drought that we have now, is there extra funding that isn't dependent on the crisis occurring and then a significant time lapse that rural people can access? And the other thing is, are most of them bulk billed by, for instance, GPs in the community?
So I'm going to answer the second bit, but before I answer the second bit, and this is the beauty of working in teams, I'm going to see if Kate knows anything about the possible financial incentive because she, you know, comes from that community.
No, I don't think there is any scheme that can help people working in those kind of sectors, unfortunately. But my answer to the second part, which you might be about to say the same thing, is that I think there have been found to be lower rates of bulk billing in rural areas, which explains why the medical expenses of people living in rural areas is generally much higher. So that is quite a problem.
So, and one of the difficulties with bulk billing, of course, is that if the, you know, government rate doesn't get put up year after year, then the gap between what it actually costs to treat someone, what you get, becomes less and less. So people abandon bulk billing just to keep their practice solvent. There are a whole lot of complex things. What I can tell you about the research that's been done is there's a whole lot of research in how to alleviate financial toxicity. I mean, we're looking at counselling and so on. And they've looked at navigators and they've looked at all sorts of things. The only thing that works is to give someone some money so far, you know, to actually relieve the financial burden. And that's why I think it's going to be important from the medical point of view to educate doctors that if they've got someone with severe financial stress, they've got to actually reduce the cost, whether it's the travel cost, they're using generic drugs, bulk billing or whatever, that's the thing that will work.
Please join me in thanking Ian and Kate, our wonderful speakers today. So this does conclude our Successful Ageing Seminar Series for 2018. I have got a small gift to say thank you to our two speakers. We will recommence our seminars again next year in 2019, and we do hope to see all of you again there. Thank you for your attendance today and for your continued interest in these seminars and in UniSA. Do have a safe journey home.